it on to Maulana Rizvi for his opening remark.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان العين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على محمد وعلى الطاهرين أما بعد فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم يريد الله بكم اليسر ولا يريد بكم العسر. Sisters and brothers in Iman, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you in this beginning of the month of Ramadan. Locally, you know, many brothers and sisters have seen the crescent tonight here in Ontario. I would like my presentation to be very simple before we open up for the question and answers. And so I'm just using some slides to make the process even faster and easier. So let me start with this. Okay, to start with, you know, let us go through some very basics, you know, that when we talk about the fasting of the month of Ramadan, it is wajib on the a person who is a Muslim, and number one, the first condition is that they be baligh, number two, of sound mind, number three, not be a traveler, number four, they should be of a physically and a healthy person. And as opposed to that, we have a category of people, because the ayat which I recited from Surah Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that I have made fasting wajib on you, but remember that I would like things to be easy and not difficult. So depending on the situation, the rules basically change. And so when it comes to the issue of exemption, you know, from fasting, we again have some people in that list, the elderly people, then you have those who are temporarily ill, or those who have, you know, long-term illness, a pregnant woman, or a nursing mother. So these are all the categories of the people who have been exempted to fast. So we'll talk more about, you know, what happens where there is total exemption, where there is, you know, qada, where is fidya, where is, what is kafara. And so let me very quickly go to some of the these terminologies, just to be clear what we are talking about. Number one, when we say qada, qada means somebody who has missed the fasting and they have to make it up. This is known as, you know, making, to make up the missed fast due to either valid excuse or out of negligence. In both cases, with qada is qada, to make it up. Then we have the term fidya. Fidya basically is a compensation to be paid for the fast missed due to valid reason. So in case of valid reason, when people are told, okay, you don't need to fast now, maybe you will do qada later on or just pay fidya. So fidya means that you have to pay something as a compensation to be paid for missed fast, for missed for a good reason accepted by the Sharia. And so what is fidya? Fidya is 750 gram of a staple food. You know, we're talking about rice or flour or any staple food. You have to pay it per day for the missed fast. And it has to be given to a needy Shia Muslim. You know, unless you don't have a deserving Shia Muslim, then you go into the other Muslims. Provided they don't have this hatred towards the Ahlul Bayt. And it's, of course, now when I say 750 grams, this is the minimum requirement. If you have the ability and if you want to do something better, then it is recommended to double that. And so you pay 1.5 kilo as a fidya for per day. Remember that fidya is not something that you give in cash. You have to miss. It has to, at the end, reach to the recipient in kind and not in cash. And so, yes, you can give the money to the organizations who are going to do this job for you, you know, but they have to make sure if this is fidya amount given to them, then they have to buy the grain and give it to the deserving people. Now, that was fidya. Coming to kafara. Kafara, and this is important, the distinction. Kafara is a fine to be paid for fast missed due to invalid reason, out of, you know, negligence. A person didn't even care about it. And this is where we had to realize that we are talking about 750 gram of rice flour or any staple food per day of the missed fast to be given to 60 needy Shia people. So 750 gram for one day will be multiplied to 60 times. So it becomes 45 kilo per day. There's a difference between fidya and kafara. Fidya is only 750 gram per day, and kafara would be 45 kilos of rice or flour per day. And here also it has to be paid in kind. So remember the difference, because many times people have this confusion between what is fidya and what is kafara. So now that we have learned this, that there are people who are exempted, and then, you know, there are the issue of qadha and fidya and kafara, let me go to the chart that I have in the book on, you know, fasting in Ramadan. Look at these categories, reasons for not fasting. The first one is old age. An elderly person who cannot fast at all, not even with difficulty, you know, they cannot, physically they are not capable of fasting because of their health or because of their old age, we are talking about. And in this case, they are exempted totally. There is no qaza for them. There is no fidya to be paid on behalf of them, and there is no kafara, of course. What about a person who is old but who can fast with difficulty? So they have some ability of fasting, but even then, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants things to be easy for you. And this is where we see that they are exempted from fasting if they have difficulty in fasting in old age. And the difference between first and second category here is that they have to pay fidya, 750 gram of rice or flour per day. No kafara, of course. Then we come to those who are temporarily ill. Somebody in the middle of the month of Ramadan had fever or severe cold or infection, and they could not fast. So it's a valid excuse. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ كَانَ مَرِيضًا أَوْ عَلَىٰ سَفَرٍ. Somebody who is not feeling well or traveling, then they are exempted those days. So in this case, because the illness was temporary, of course they have to do qadha within 1 year. It's before the next Ramadan starts. Then they will only do qadha and there is nothing. But if they were not able to do the qadha in that 1 year grace period till next Ramadan, and they postpone that for after the second Ramadan, then the fidya would be added to that. So there is a qaza and a fidya in case of those who missed the fast for a good reason, which was temporary illness. Then we go to the category of the people who have, you know, long-term illness. Somebody who is diabetic, for example, or somebody has, in a situation where they need to eat and drink more frequently. Otherwise, it's going to be very harmful for their health. They are also, you know, exempted from fasting. There will be no issue of qadha for them. However, they will have to pay fidya, 750 gram per day. Then we come to the situation of a pregnant woman who thinks that by fasting, you know, it might have an impact negatively on the health of the baby. And that's where she needs to eat and drink and keep herself, you know, healthy so that the baby can develop in a normal way. In this case, of course, she will be exempted. She has to do the qadha when it becomes possible for her. And, you know, of course, if and then she also has to pay fidya. Now, then we also come to the nursing mother. The child is born and now the mother is breastfeeding. In that case also, if she feels that by fasting, it will have an impact on production of her milk, and that will have an impact on the development and health of the child, then she is also exempted from fasting, and she will do the qadha later on, and of course she has to pay the fidya also. Now, I would like to clarify one thing. You know, there's a lot of discussion going on in social media, from here to all the way to Dar es Salaam, that, you know, our Sistani says that if a mother is nursing her baby and if she has an alternative way of feeding, then she is not exempted from fasting. And one of the examples mentioned is that if she is able to feed the child by formula, for example. Now, you know, we had to realize the question was sent to Ayatollah Sistani where he, you know, it was mentioned to him that when we talk about the milk of the mother, this is more beneficial. Even, you know, Islam recommends that in a way. And we had to realize that if the mother stops breastfeeding the child and, you know, starts using formula temporarily, the child doesn't like this change. And after Ramadan, you know, the child would not go back to breastfeeding. So this can have an impact, and this will be considered to be dharar, you know, harm for the development of the child. And so in that case also, you know, even though you have this option of using formula, you know, but if it's going to be detrimental to the long-term development of the child, then such a nursing mother is also exempted. Of course, she has to do qadha later on and pay fidya. Then we come to the category of the people who are traveling. If you start your journey before the Zuhr time on the day you are traveling, then that day's fast is fine. Okay, no, this is before Zuhr, sorry. If you, on the day of fasting, you start your journey, and if you leave your city before Zuhr time, then your fast of that day is not valid. However, in this case, you just have to do qadha, because traveling is not haram in the state of fasting, in the month of Ramadan. It's not one of the 9 or 10 things which are in muftirat that is haram for you to travel in the month of Ramadan. No, so if you decide to travel before Zuhr, that day's fast will not be valid, and you will have to do qadha. However, if you start your journey after the Zuhr time, then that day's fasting is fine, and you will just fast on that day normally. So once you reach to your destination, what will happen? If you're going to stay there for less than 10 days, then you are a musafir. Man kana maridan aw ala safar, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Baqarah says, those who are not feeling well or on a journey, then they will fast other days after the month of Ramadan. So a person is considered to be musafir, a traveler, if he is going to stay in the destination for less than 10 days. That person cannot fast, and he will have to make it up later on after the month of Ramadan. There is no qaza in that case, no fidya there either. However, if you reach to the destination where you are going to stay continuously for 10 days or more, then you are no more considered to be a musafir. It's as if you are home. And so then you will fast normally. And of course, there is no issue of qadha there, no fidya, no kafara. What about frequent traveler? You know, a person whose job is traveling itself. You know, a pilot, train, driver or truck driver. This is their job to transfer goods and persons from one place to another. If a person's job involves traveling for 4 months accumulatively in 1 year, then they will be classified as kathir al-safar, frequent traveler. And for them, fasting and prayers would be normal, even when they are traveling. So they will have to fast, they will have to pray also full. Now we come to the last category. If there is an individual who didn't fast because of any of the good reasons the Sharia has given, it's also negligence, then they have to do qadha, and of course, then they have to pay kafara. Kafara is fine. Remember the difference between fidya and in kafara. Now, let me now talk about this issue of, you know, the usage of medicine while you are fasting. It depends how it's being administered. If it's by the mouth, then the roza and the fasting will become invalid. You know, sometimes I get questioned that, you know, Maulana, it's just one small pill. I need to, you know, eat that at midday time. You can't. You know, if you take anything by mouth, you know, any medication or drink something, then your roza will become batil. However, there is one thing you have to keep in mind, that the use of puffer for somebody who has asthma is okay, because the spray enters the respiratory tract and not the passage of food and drink. And therefore, you know, there is no problem in using the puffer. So if it's not from mouth, other routes. For example, if feeding tube is being used, then the fasting would be become batil, will become invalid. It's not allowed. Liquid enema, if it is used for a certain situation in a medical situation. Again, that will invalidate the fast. IV drip is okay when you are fasting. There is no, it doesn't harm. Nasal and eye drops, that also has no, you know, no problem if you are doing that in the state of fasting. So IV drip, nasal and eye drops. And the final one here is the issue of injection. Any kind of injection for medical purpose, for vaccination. You know, in the last few days, I've been getting more than, you know, 5-7 emails or telephone calls. Can we get the, you know, a corona vaccine while you are fasting? There is no problem at all getting injection or, you know, getting vaccine in the state of fasting is not a problem at all. It doesn't harm your fasting. Please spread this word around, because, you know, people have a lot of doubts about it. Not only that, can you go for blood test when you are fasting? Even that would not invalidate the fast. Actually, you can even go for blood donation. However, remember that if donating the blood in the state of fasting is going to make you weak and unable to continue fasting, then that is not allowed. But if you are able to you know, go through blood donation if you want and still maintain your fast, it's okay. So So the main thing, of course, here for us is the issue of blood test. Blood test also in the state of fasting and roza is okay. It doesn't invalidate the fast at all. Now, finally, let me now, if you visit this website, al-m.ca, you know, / there, Ramadan. If you are not sure about your situation, the things that we have discussed, whether you fit in this category or that category, then you can actually go to this website and you will be able to, you know, it's a more interactive guide to find answers on the issue of illness or travel or medicine use or fidya and kafara or qada and many other things. So you will just select your situations and, you know, and select the answer the questions there, and you will get the response right away. For example, you know, when you go to this page there, you know, look at the headings there and see, well, what you're looking for. You know, when we talk about the situation of illness, for example, or motherhood, you know, select whether it's a pregnancy or the issue of nursing. And this is where, after you selected the scenario, you will get your answer there. Well, for example, when you talk about fasting, you know, you can look at that issue of fasting during the month of Ramadan. Are you traveling out of town, sitting limits or not? If you select yes, then the question comes up, you know, you are going before Zuhur or after Zuhur. And this is how you'll get the response, depending on the situation that you select for yourself. Now, people who live in the Greater Toronto Area, that website also has an interactive, you know, map for you. If you want to find out, you know, from your GTA boundary, that's the boundary around, that if you travel, you know, how far you're going, what is allowable, you know, distance as far as your qaza prayers or the fasting issue is concerned. And this is where, you know, for example, when you go into let's say you're going to Hamilton, to Rizvi Islamic Center there. You have put that as a destination. And then you go to this you know, when you are going through QEW to Hamilton, you select that point and you will get the coordination of that, and you put that as part of your origin. So then you will see that from that border to Rizvi Center is only 21 kilometers. And that is less than 22. It's only when you travel 22, that's where the qasr issue starts. So this you know, a map will basically help you you will be able to figure it out, you know, what are the limits as far as, you know, traveling and namaz and roza is concerned. And of course, now we'll open up. If you have questions, this is your time to basically, you know, ask your questions.
Thank you so much, Maulana. So just as a reminder for everyone, if you'd like to submit a question and also vote on other questions, please go to menti.com and use the code 9820330. With that, we'll start with the first question. So if a person is suffering from severe anxiety attacks and mental illness and is on medication, what is the ruling on fasting for this person?
In that case, I don't think that person would be obliged to the fast. He will be exempted because anxiety is a situation where it's a kind of a lower level of, let's say, mental situation, mental illness. And so if person by fasting is going to go through aggravated situation because of the anxiety, then they don't have to fast. If they have the ability to pay fidya, that's good.
Thank you, Maulana. The next question is, if someone has a filling or a dental appointment, is that okay for the fast?
It depends. As long as the person in that process does not swallow water, it should be okay. But if they end up swallowing the water, then their fast will become batil. It will become invalid.
Thank you, Maulana. The next question is, the cost of kafara in Pakistan is a lot less than in Canada. Based on that cost, can someone choose to choose the country where they want to pay their kafara?
Absolutely, yes, they can do that. And that's why when it comes to fidya and kafara, we don't give out dollar value, because it all depends where you are giving. The recipient has to receive that in kind. So if you're giving in Pakistan, India, or Iraq, or Tanzania, for example, so you'll have to figure it out that, you know, that 750 gram, what is the value over there? And so it's not necessary that you pay according to the Canadian value, no.
Thank you. The next question is, is it okay for someone with dry lips to use Vaseline gel? And what if they were to lick their lips accidentally?
That is okay, but they have to be careful. You know, maybe licking wouldn't harm by itself. The main thing is that, you know, one should not be swallowing anything. Yeah. So
the next question,
they can do that, okay, but they have to be extra careful when they are in the state of fasting.
Thank you, Maulana. The next question is reciting azan and iqama necessary in prayer?
Azan and iqama are not necessary. They are highly recommended, especially the iqama is more recommended than the azan.
Thank you. Can you explain the concept of imsak and why imsak time is different than fajr? Which is the time that we should be following for fasting?
The actual timing of fasting is from fajr to maghrib. What you have in the timetables where they say imsak, that is actually just a practical, you know, step and method devised by the community almost everywhere. Because if you look at the, for example, the clocks or the watch of the people, in the same people or the same clocks, you know, multiple clocks in the same house, you will see they are not exactly same. One might be fast, another one might be slow. And, you know, this is where the issue comes up, that it is always better to take precaution and stop few minutes before the actual fajr time. And so, for example, here in our timetable, we have fixed that as 5 minutes before fajr. In some timetables, there are 15 minutes or 20 minutes. You know, imsak is not really a time where you say, okay, the sun has reached to so many degrees below the horizon, you know, before the sunset or before dawn, and therefore that's imsak. Now, imsak just means to stop yourself from eating and drinking as a precaution. Yeah.
The next question is pretty similar to the last one, as it has to do with timing as well. So are we allowed to pray at the exact specified time for Salat, or should we allow some cushion before starting prayers, especially for Fajr?
Other prayers, we are kind of more, certain and sure about it. Fajr is always an issue. And therefore, giving a few minutes, and that's where probably the adhan and iqama will come handy. Start doing that. So by the time you come for namaz time, it's already, 4 or 5 minutes gone.
If I forget to eat sari and I'm extremely hungry during the day and my stomach and my head is hurting tremendously, would this be considered as zulu and would my fast be permissible?
What is the term he has used, this person? Would this be considered
zulu? Z-U-L-U.
Oh, zarar. Okay. Zarar means harm. Okay. No, fasting means not eating and drinking, and so you suffer a little bit. Yes, that's part of the whole exercise of fasting. If it becomes that difficult, rest, sleep. But no, that will not be considered as zarar. Human beings have the capability of staying hungry for more than one day.
Is steam inhalation with essential oils for medical reasons to alleviate cold or flu symptoms, for example, permissible during a fast?
If you are inhaling, the vapors there with which have medication in it, then there will be a problem, yes. Because it is basically what we call it's thick, dust kind of, although it's a medication there. But so just vapor water, in that sense, maybe it would be fine. But when it comes to the issue of medication, no.
The next question is, so my child had medical problems since childhood, but I never took out fidya because I thought that due to her illness, I thought fidya is also not mandatory. What should I do now?
If it was because of the illness, then they have to do qadha and give the fidya. Well, you can gradually do the payment of the fidya. So for 1 month, the fidya for somebody who didn't fast for the whole month would be 22 and a half kilo of rice or flour or any staple grain. Yeah.
I get migraine headaches while fasting. What is the ruling if I cannot continue with my fast?
You will have to fast and then try to manage yourself. If there are fixed timings that you go through that, and try to see if you can, relax or even sleep. But if it's going to be, if it reaches to a point where it is really not bearable anymore, then at that moment you can break your fast. But migraine by itself would not be an excuse of not fasting at all. You'll have to take every day, fast and see how it goes.
Is it okay to plan a vacation trip on purpose during Ramadan? This would be within 10 days to avoid fasting with the intention of paying qaza later.
Technically speaking, yes. If somebody wants to do that, yes, they can do that. But they have to really think about it, before they make the decision. Is it because of, let's say, Ramadan happens to be in summer and this person finds it very difficult? And so he wants to travel and then do the qadha in winter time. Yeah, so it depends on the situation, but yes, technically that person is allowed because traveling in Ramadan is not forbidden.
What would the case be if a colonoscopy has been scheduled to take place in Ramadan and is recommended by the doctor?
The fast would not be valid at that time. So the person has to do qadha, that's all.
Is using Listerine allowed during fasting? Which is a mouthwash.
The mouthwash, yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, you have to be careful, yes. It is allowed, but in the month of Ramadan, you have to be extra careful. You know, avoid using it, or even if you use it in a much lesser amount than you would do normally, and be careful that it doesn't go in your throat.
And what about brushing teeth?
Brushing teeth is not a problem, no, no. Again, the main issue is that make sure no liquid goes inside, down the throat, anyway.
Is it recommended to break the fast at Awwal time or pray Maghrib and Isha and then break the fast?
According to the examples that I have seen in the Hadith and even the example, the seerah of the Imams, actually it is praying Maghrib and then doing the Iftar.
My child is mature and married. And they don't fast. Can we visit the child during Ramadan for iftar or invite him or her for Eid dinner?
Well, what the person is doing is his responsibility. They will be accountable in the eyes of Allah. That doesn't prevent you from visiting them or inviting them in Ramadan or in Eid.
Do we have to do niyat for each day in Ramadan? What if I forget one day? Is my fast still valid?
Niyat is actually, the first point is that it's not something which has to be done verbally. Secondly, it doesn't have to be done for every day specifically. You can just write, like tonight, you can do the niyat that, you know, from tomorrow I'm going to fast. For this month. And that awareness is sufficient. You don't have to repeat the niyat every day.
If you are traveling but arrive to your destination before Zuhr, can you fast?
If you're traveling and reach to your destination before Zuhr and you're going to stay there for 10 days, or you are coming back home and reach there before Zuhr, provided you did not eat or drink from the Fajr point, wherever you reach to Fajr, till that time, then yes, you can fast on that day. But if you had the breakfast, let's say in the plane while you're coming back home, and then you come here, it's just before Zuhr, then you cannot fast because you had the breakfast.
What is the rule about tasting food for cooking purposes during fasting?
There is no problem there. This is not even karahat, you know. For somebody who is cooking the food or the iftar, if they want to taste, that's fine. As long as they do not swallow anything.
One of my parents is sick and can't fast. I'm not sure yet if it is a long-term illness or not. If it becomes long-term where they cannot fast, when do they pay fidya?
They can pay the fidya after the month of Ramadan, or if it's something which is, you come to realize that this has continued for a few years, then even in the beginning of Ramadan, paying that would be fine.
if I didn't know something invalidated my fast when I was younger and I found out afterwards, what should I do now?
If your ignorance was out of innocence, then it's okay. You don't have to worry about it. But if your ignorance was based on negligence, you didn't really care about it, then that becomes an issue, or at least then you had to make a qadha for it.
If many fasts have been missed and one cannot afford to pay kafara, how does one handle this?
They should try their best and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness.
If I travel before Zohar, we have to fast until we cross the boundary, correct?
Yes, if you're going to travel on a certain day, then it doesn't mean that on that day you will not fast. You still have to fast until you cross the boundary and reach to a point where you are so far that you cannot see the houses on the border of your city. And that's where you will be allowed to eat or drink. So it's not just at the border. It is at what is known as hadd tarakhus, means the limit where you now have permission to eat and drink. And that's not defined in kilometers. It all depends. So you leave your city boundary and travel a little bit there where you can no more, you know, clearly see the houses at the, you know, city limits, then that will be hadd tarakhus for you.
If one continues to eat after imsak, not knowing or forgetting the time to eat has finished, is the fast still in order?
If it was by mistake, it's fine. But if it was out of negligence, then there will be a problem. They have to do qadha. There is no kafara, but they have to do qadha, yeah.
How can we let our fitrah get closer and connect to Allah in the month of Ramadan? And how do we increase our intellect to educate others about Ramadan?
Well, it's more, you know, studying and contemplating and thinking about fasting. Fasting has all these different levels, you know, a basic level where you just adhere to the, you know, fiqhi rules that you abstain from food and drink and certain other things. Then you have to think about it more, that, you know, what is more into it. And that's where you get to the level of implications, where you improve your character, your behavior, how you know, interact with people. And then, you know, finally you reach to a stage where you come to realize that, you know, I should be able to control my desires and be the master of whatever I have rather than be the slave of it. And so there are all different levels of fasting, and I would recommend you to go to that website, al-m.ca. There is a book they can download free. It's called Fasting in Ramadan. And there's a couple of articles, 3-4 pages each, which talks about this spiritual dimension of fasting and different levels of fasting also.
If a lady who has not repaid her missed fasts within the next year for a few years, does she have to pay fidya for every year missed?
No, that's only one time. So if she didn't do the qaza within 1 year, and then she does it after a year, then it's qaza plus one fidya. It will not be multiplied.
If eye drops or nasal drops are felt in the throat and it enters the feeding tube, then according to Ayatollah Khui, is the fast valid?
According to Ayatollah Khui, if you can feel it in your throat, then that will be a problem. But according to Ayatollah Sistani, no, that wouldn't be a problem. So there's a difference of opinion between two of them. Since, you know, in case of those who are the muqallideen of Ayatollah Khui, if they did that, not realizing what will happen, so they just have to do qadha. There is no kafara there, no. Go ahead.
Thank you, Maulana. So the next question is, what do you define as old age?
I can't give you an age there. What I would say, there are some people who are old but still very young in their heart and spirit. They can go through, these challenges of fasting, and then there are some who might be younger in age than, you know, such an individual, but they would be physically weak, you know. So there's no fixed age as such. A person has to make that decision themselves, yeah.
Maulana, I'll preface this one by saying this was the most voted question of the night.
Okay.
Yeah. When I get hungry during a fast, I like to watch videos of people eating. Is this permissible?
Yes, it is permissible as long as you don't eat. But why would you want to torture yourself? You know? Because you are hungry, you see people eating, you see shows where people are eating, you know, the desire will increase. Yeah.
Salam, I am a 9-year-old boy. Can I do half fast?
Yes, since you are not become baligh, yes, you can do half fast. You know, normally parents introduce their children gradually into fasting, even before they come to the age of, you know, bulugh, even before 9, especially for girls. So that's how they are introduced. You know, they might do the sahri, and then after 4 or 5 hours, you know, they will eat. Maybe next time a little bit longer, or in weekends or the vacation time. So they get used to the idea that when they become baligh or at the age of 9 and further down, you know, they basically would be able to handle the issue of fasting. So yes, you cannot introduce a child to fast continuously just like that all of a sudden. They have to be introduced gradually into it.
Thank you, Maulana. The next question is, should women with breastfeeding children supplement with formula or pumped milk for the month of Ramadan so that they can fast?
If they do not consider that to be detrimental to the normal, you know, development of their child, then they can do that, yes. But if a mother feels otherwise, then she should not feel guilty about it. She has been given that exemption. See, I have a problem when people put this as a guilt on the nursing mothers, that you are not fulfilling the duty. No, you know, if you feel that by fasting you are going to, you know, have a negative impact on the development of the child, then you have that exemption.
As we know, it is recommended to put water in the nose for wudu. If we put water in the nose and the water goes up the nose, would that be permissible while fasting?
Well, in this state of fasting, you have to be careful about these issues. whether you are gargling or putting the water in the nose. If it's, since it's not done intentionally, it should be okay, but you have to be careful about it.
In past years, I owed kafara, but I just made donations to the poor, and these donations were not in kind. Do I need to repay the kafara?
Yes, you have to make sure that at the end, the recipient is given the grain, rice or flour or whatever is, you know, the staple food in that region. It could be lenten, it could be maize. It depends where it's been given. Yeah. Whatever you had given would be considered to be sadaqah and charity, inshallah.
If a person has to pay kafara, can it be given to one person?
When it comes to the kafara, the ruling is that you should actually feed for one day 60 eligible, you know, poor people. Now, for us to manage that here would not be easy. So the best way there is basically to give the grain to multiple, you know, recipients, or give it to, let's say, an orphanage, you know, so it's multiple of, you know, recipients who are getting that food. So it's not one individual, no.
The next question is, I never made up my fast missed due to haze through so many years and only recently found out about the fact that qaza fasts need to be completed within 1 year. What should I do now?
So she didn't do the qaza?
No.
Okay, yeah, and then she has to make it up gradually, maybe during the winter time. And of course, she will have to then also pay fidya for it. There's no kafara in that case.
The next question is, what did the Holy Prophet and the Imam have for iftar?
What did they have?
Yes.
Okay. Offhand, no. I had to look for it. What was the menu? I don't know. It must have been the simple food that they had those days. Yeah.
If one belches while wearing a mask in the state of fasting and that causes them to pass out, does this invalidate the fast? And I believe belching is a medical condition.
Can you repeat that again, the question?
If one belches while wearing a mask in the state of fasting and that causes them to pass out, does this invalidate the fast?
No, since this was not done intentionally, it's okay. It's only when you voluntarily go to the state where you are made unconscious, you know, for a medical procedure or something like that. That's where the fast will break. But if it's done, if it happens by itself, then no, there's no problem.
The next question is, is there a recent fatwa from Syed Sistani about not fasting if you have a dry throat and nose so that you can take medicine or water and prevent COVID-19?
No, there is nothing recent about it. And there is it's just that, you know, sometimes people ask all these questions in a way. They say, oh, you know, the doctors are saying that if you keep your mouth and throat dry, then there is more chances of getting COVID-19, you know, coronavirus. First of all, doctors don't really say that. You know, that this is a question which was asked last year. And so it's not that just because a person has dry mouth or throat, you know, they will get the virus. It comes from other, you know, elements, whether it's human contact or, you know, and so it's not just the dryness of the mouth and the throat which causes that. And so, no, that's not an excuse for not fasting.
Thank you, Maulana. The next question, I'm not sure if I'll pronounce the word correctly here, but are the ruling of Rahbar similar to Syed Sistani?
Rahbar here is referring to Ayatollah Khamenei. On most issues, yes. In some, there might be, like, for example, when I had the chart about the use of medicine in fasting, the issue of puffer that we talked about, you know, the ruling of Ayatollah Khoi, Ayatollah Sistani, as well as late Imam Khomeini was that that was okay. Ayatollah Khamenei has a slightly different view there. He says if a person is able to fast after the Ramadan normally without using the puffer, then they should fast later on. So other than that, I don't think there is a major difference on those rulings. Yes, one more. Majority of the mujtahideen, when they list the items which are forbidden in the state of fasting, one of them is to submerge your head into water. So swimming in a way where your head is submerged in the water will invalidate your fast. This is the general ruling of the mujtahideen. But according to Ayatollah Sistani, that is not the case. Yeah.
Thank you, Maulana. The next question is, if a person is traveling for work, which is more than the boundary described, will he become a frequent traveler? And if that person then travels to another country and is staying less than 10 days, then what is the rule?
Well, a person becomes frequent traveler if his work itself is traveling, or he has to travel to reach to his work. If this traveling happens for 4 months in a year, accumulatively, and then that person is considered to be a frequent traveler. And then for him or her, prayers and fasting is to be done normally. So it's not just one time, you know, or 10 times in a year. It has to be that it's considered to be, you know, one third of the year that a person is traveling or more. That is how it's going to be defined.
Thank you, Maulana. The next question is, if someone has a mustahab fast and another mu'min offers food to them, is it recommended to break the fast just on offering? Or is it conditional only on if that person will get upset?
Well, if you have a mustahab fast on one hand, and then you have, you know, a mu'min inviting you to eat, especially not knowing that you are fasting. So you have two good deeds. One is mustahab fast, and one is your fellow, you know, mu'min or mu'mina, you know, inviting. Accepting their invitation also is a good deed. So we are told that in this case, you will sacrifice the mustahab fast and accept the invitation of the mu'min or the mu'mina. But remember, this has to be genuine. Not that, you know, you tell somebody in the family that, oh, tomorrow I'm going to fast mustahab, so, you know, invite me for lunch. it shouldn't be planned in that way. No. Yeah. It has to be genuine. Yeah.
Can we eat until Fajr time instead of Imsak?
I would strongly recommend to adhere to the Imsak timing, especially in our timetable where it's only 5 minutes before Fajr. But if somehow, someday you got up late and, you know, then just make sure your time, your clock is very accurate and you stop before Fajr.
The next question is, I have my final exams coming up next week, and I know that fasting will affect the way I perform. Can I skip the fast and pay kafara?
Well, it's not a valid excuse by itself. So if you skip the fast, then you have to do qada as well as pay kafara. However, Ayatollah Sistani was asked about it, and he says you should fast on that day. Means if it is an exam which is very crucial for your future or profession or your, you know, upgrading yourself. So if it is essential, then you still need to fast on that day. You're not exempted on that day. However, see, if by middle of the day you are not able to handle it, the concentration is not there, or there is a headache or something like that, in that case, you will be allowed to break the fast and then do the qada later on. And there will be no kafara. So it's not an exemption from before. It is every day of that exam period you will have to start the day with fasting anyway. So if one day you are able to go through it, the fasting as well as your studies or exam, then that would be normal. Yeah.
If my son is at age 11 and wants to start fasting, should I facilitate that or should I tell him that it is not compulsory?
Well, if the child himself is interested, why not? Encourage him.
The next question is, what if I have to travel for a day but reach the destination before Zohar and return back home after Zohar?
If you reach to the destination before Zohar, so that was not your home. That's what I'm assuming. And you did not stay, you were not staying there for 10 days. Because the question is that on the same day then that person reaches home, because he's reaching home after Zohar, you know, the fast would not be, because he traveled before Zohar, this would not be valid. The only situation where the fast would be valid is suppose somebody left his hometown early in the morning, after Fajr, went to other city, did his job, whatever he wanted to do, and then he was able to come back and reach home before, reach to the town before Zohar. In that case, it is fine.
One has become baligh, and I wasn't aware, and neither was he. What is the ruling on that?
Well, because this is out of ignorance, then he has to do qada. There will be no penalty for that, no.
The next question is also related to traveling. So if I'm traveling by plane to my home country right after Zohar, and my flight lands at the time of Fajr in that country, am I still not exempt from fasting for that day?
So he's going back home?
He's going back home. And he leaves right after Zohar, but he lands in at home at the time of Fajr.
Okay. Well, basically, if he traveled at a time where during the flight it was already Maghrib time, then he should do Iftar and Sahar. And if he reaches home before Fajr or before Zohar time, then he will be fasting. Provided he did not eat anything from his point of Fajr till the reaching of his town. Yeah.
Thank you, Maulana.
So if he wants that concession, then, you know, while he's still traveling before reaching home, reaching his town, if he eats breakfast, which is allowed for him because he's in the state of traveling, then he will not be able to fast even though he reached there before Zohar because he had his breakfast there.
Thank you, Maulana. The next question is, if a person is fasting and he speaks a hadith that which he knows is sahih, but after the fast is over, he finds out that the hadith was not sahih. Is that fast valid?
The hadith, sahih or da'if, is not an issue, whether it is authentic or, you know, weak. The issue is that making up a statement just out of the blue and saying, Qala Rasulullah, you know, Rasulullah said this, or Imam said this, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said this. That statement, you know, ascribing a wrong statement knowingly to Allah, Rasul, or Imam, makes the fast invalid. But if he quoted a hadith from Biharul Anwar, and later on he was told this is Za'if, then no, he's okay. He didn't make it up. He was just quoting, and, you know, he gave the reference, for example. So then that's okay.
I did not fast during my early years, and now I'm ill and unable to fast. Can I pay fidya for all of those years?
If it was missed out because of ignorance, out of innocence, and that is their own consciousness to decide that, or was it ignorance out of negligence? You know, so those two terms are very important. So, or if it was not just an issue of ignorance, it was just, you know, didn't really, the environment was not good or something, then they have to at least give the fidya, yes. And they will have to make wasiyat, you know, in their will, that, you know, so many months of fasting I have missed when I was young, and so I would like this to be made up after I pass away. Now, in that also, the normal ruling of the mujtahideen is that if the will was made and this person, for example, dedicated some money to hire somebody to fast on his behalf, then that's what should be done. Otherwise, when it comes to the parents, the oldest child has an option of, you know, paying just fidya amount in lieu of the missed fast of the father or the mother. They don't necessarily have to hire somebody. That is Ayatollah Sistani's ruling.
Thank you, Maulana. The next question is, if a person has missed their fast and cannot repay it before the next year, and the year after, is fidya to be paid for every year that lapses?
No, it's only, it will be just twice then. That's all. For the first year and the second, that's all.
The next question is, I have been told that if you accidentally eat while fasting and you didn't mean to, you are allowed to continue so long as you rinse your mouth and there is no excess food left. Is that okay?
Yeah, if somebody eats a drink by mistake, you know, unknowingly, he said that at that moment didn't realize he's fasting, then that's okay. Yes, of course, he has to rinse his mouth, so there's nothing remaining there, which we would be swallowing then. So that's is okay. So for example, you know, somebody went through the normal jogging or routine exercise, came home, felt thirsty, and normally that's what the people will do, just goes and drinks water and thus realizes, oh, I'm fasting today. So that's okay. That doesn't harm the fast. Although to say that, you know, to eat proper food, a little bit takes imagination to reach there without realizing because you have to do some preparation. Eating, drinking water is okay. That's understandable. Yeah. Okay.
Thank you, Maulana. So the next question is, I have a mental disorder and I need to take my medications at certain times. Am I exempted from fasting?
Yes, the person would be exempted from fasting and he should pay fidya. Yes.
So we'll continue with two more questions, inshallah.
Okay.
If a woman's menstrual cycle starts whilst fasting, is that fast still valid if it starts at a certain time?
No, even if it starts a minute before the Maghrib time, it becomes invalid. Because one of the conditions of validity of fasting is that a person should be in that state of, for the women especially, they should be free from that state.
Thank you, Maulana. And the last question here is, Ramadan is supposed to be a month of humility and supplication to the religion. Yet we see people arranging superfluous iftars. Would this not counter the spirit of Ramadan?
Well, you know, feeding the mu'mineen and mu'minat in iftar is a good thing. If a person is, you know, offering good food to others in Ramadan, that's it by itself is nothing wrong there, provided his own, you know, normal iftar is normal. Yeah. So if you are
Thank
the
you
host,
so much.
Then that's fine. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Maulana. We appreciate you taking the time to answer our questions. And thank you everyone so much for joining. And we hope you found this session beneficial. Just as a reminder, this video will be up on Jaffrey Community Center's YouTube channel later for viewing. Also remember to visit al-m.ca/Ramadan for all the content covered today and many more FAQs as well. And with that, khuda hafiz and have a great night, inshallah.
Okay, khuda hafiz.